Got to have the pen. That always makes you look official when you're doing a show there, Mike. That's what you got to have, that good pen. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're back live on the Philippe Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. Yep, big show today, highly anticipated today. Many of you know I have had Dr. Jacqueline Battalora on. I've lost count now on how many times, and she is an amazing historian. Recently I was in Chicago with her, and she drove me by the library, the law library, where she discovered white people for the first time. She tells the story, and Birth of a White Nation is the name of her book, and it's absolutely incredible. And then, as a result of her work, we stumbled upon an anthropologist who is doing anthropology in 10 minutes. It's absolutely amazing. I've sent his videos to everybody. I mean, there are people calling me all over the country and the world saying, dude, this is really good stuff. So he used some of Battalora's work because she had talked about Bacon's Rebellion. He did a piece on Bacon's Rebellion and the invention of white people as well. So, of course, I had to invite him on the show. So that's what I do. So we're here with Michael Kilman. He's an applied anthropologist and digital media specialist. The two kind of overlap. You can kind of see that as we're going forward. He received an undergraduate degree in anthropology and religious studies from Metropolitan State University of Denver. Michael conducted his graduate work at Portland State University and earned his MS in applied anthropology. And in the last 5 years, Michael has conducted ethnographic research in Nevada, Oregon, and Colorado, and Nueve Leon, Mexico. I always get that. I'm not good at the Spanish. All right. How are you, Michael?
I'm doing pretty good. How are you doing today?
I'm good, bud. I'm good. Thank you for being with me and taking the time. When I talk to you, every time I talk to you, you are always doing something. You are so busy. You have a crazy life. I'm just going to tell you right now while we're on air. You are nuts. You are doing everything.
Life.
So I want to run through first just kind of setting the tone of what is anthropology and what is ethnographic study and research. First, what is ethnographic research and study? Let's start there, and then we'll get into anthropology and move forward from there.
Well, the easiest way to think about ethnography is this, right? We have photography, which is, you know, taking a picture of something. So mm-hmm. An ethnography is really just kind of snapshots of culture, getting kind of like a piece of understanding of a wider cultural system or structure. So, and a lot of people tend to think of anthropology, they think of things like, going and living with an indigenous tribe in the Amazon, or shamans or things like that. But anthropology has a lot of applications to the modern world. We do a lot of things like look at globalization, migration, climate change, obviously issues of race, class, gender, religion. We look at all kinds of different stuff. And we use ethnography as a particular kind of tool and set of methods that allows us to really capture kind of some trends that are going on culturally.
Excellent, excellent. Now you did I don't know if it was a series, but I know it was a video that I saw that I loved called What the Bleep is Anthropology? And that was so well done with the milk and everything. You guys have to see it. And we're going to have to get your web address and YouTube channel so people can go see what you've done. But a lot of people have heard of anthropology, but most people, we haven't, including myself, haven't got a clue about it. What is it, and what it, you know? Let's talk about these aspects of anthropology.
Sure. So, and that episode is the very first episode of Anthropology in 10 or Less, and I started with that episode because exactly what you're saying. Most people don't know what anthropology is, or they think it has something to do with Indiana Jones. They asked me about dinosaur bones, which is another one I get quite a bit. So, sure. But really anthropology, the term anthro essentially means human. And apology is the study of. So really anthropology at its core is the study of humans. And particularly, I think a lot of what we're interested in is what is the human experience? And there are four basic fields that we have in anthropology. The most famous one probably is archaeology, and that's why we think of Indiana Jones. But that archaeology is actually a subfield of anthropology. And what it basically does is allow us to look at human stuff, because humans make a lot of things. And by understanding those things that we make through both the present and the ancient past, we can understand a little bit more about what it was like to be human in that particular context.
Okay.
The second field subfield is linguistics. So that's the study of the relationship between language and culture, because there's definitely a relationship between how you perceive your world and the way that you frame it through language. And this is a big debate on what that relationship is in cultural linguistics in particular. But there's definitely a connection between culture and language. And you can see this with like all kinds of new words and stuff. And the one I always like to mention when I'm lecturing to my students is, you know, bootylicious. That's a word that has a very specific cultural context and place and time. And by understanding that's actually a dictionary word now, you can.
Is it really? It actually became a legalized.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. And if you go ahead and any of your audience out there, go ahead and Google new words for December of like 2016. Webster adds a whole bunch of new words each year, and some of them are just absolutely hilarious. Some of them are like respawn, like in video games, or like crony capitalism or Obamacare, and these get officially added into the dictionary. And so cultural linguistics can look at that kind of stuff and also how language is put together. They do what we call descriptive linguistics, which looks at how sentence structure and sounds are used to kind of construct communication. But by understanding what kind of new words are around, how language is changing, then we can have an idea of what's going on in the kind of human experience at that particular time.
Or you also talk about it as being a study of dead, dying, and living languages.
Yes, absolutely. So, and also, too, I worked with a group up in Oregon called the Language Hunters. And they're a nonprofit organization. And what they do is they've kind of invented language games. And they have like a little board game and everything now. And the purpose of it is if you can find just one fluent speaker left, you can use these language games as a strategy to reclaim dying languages. And so there's a lot of work in applied linguistic anthropology that looks at kind of recording and preserving languages that are dying and looking at different methods to revitalize dying languages. Because it's absolutely the case that if you lose language, you lose a big part of the culture. And the simple way of explaining this is that there are concepts that just do not translate into other languages. That mm-hmm. if you lose those concepts, you lose the true understanding of the nature of the experience. So.
Now, you also talk about cultural anthropology.
Yes.
And cultural anthropology is the third piece.
Yeah. And cultural anthropology is my area of specialty in particular. That's where I put a lot of my energy and focus into. And that focuses on what does the present human culture look like at the moment. And we do that by understanding, you know, what are the subsistence patterns? In other words, how do they put food on the table? Do they go and work at Starbucks, or are they gathering corn in the field? Are they hunting animals? Those kind of things. We look at things like religion, race, class, gender, all of the various sub-elements of culture. And we look at how those are all kind of configured and how they're kind of netted together. Because mm-hmm. culture is very much a net. It's not. It's a very integrated whole. It's not like you can't really just look at like an economic system and really understand what's going on in the culture. You have to look at how that reacts or relates to other elements within culture. So, and the last one is physical or biological anthropology. These are the individuals who go out into the middle of really hot and dry places and excavate ancient fossils and look at the origins of humans. They're the ones who study things like paleopathology, ancient disease. So what killed King Tut exactly is like a paleopathology question. They might look at, look at human remains to understand plagues. They may understand, we have forensic anthropologists like that show Bones.
Mm-hmm.
All my forensic anthropologist friends have some problems in with the show Bones in terms of its scientific validity, but it at least has gotten people interested in forensic anthropology. But yeah, so you have these four kind of subfields within anthropology, and all anthropologists know a little bit about each, but it tends to be the case that we specialize in one or the other.
Okay, so you talk about three different elements of what's known as the anthropological lens: cultural or cross-cultural comparison, holism, and cultural relativism. Can you walk us through that?
Yeah. So we have, in cultural anthropology in particular, we have these three kinds of ways of looking at the world that makes anthropology unique from other social science. The first one is cross-cultural comparison. So we would take a look at how do cultures stack up? How do they compare? What are the similarities? What are the differences? For example, all humans have to eat. If you don't eat, you die. So all culture necessarily has some element of subsistence around it, right? So we can look at how does a culture in the heart of the Amazon compare to people living on the edge of the Ganges River, to people living in New York or Tokyo or various other places. And so we can compare their various strategies and look at the similarities and differences. The second part is kind of what I already started to touch on a little bit, holism. Mm-hmm. Holism is the idea of looking at the human experience as a holistic encounter. We can't just isolate one element of the cultural experience or the human experience, because all of our identity, all of our reality is kind of constructed out of a whole bunch of different information and experiences. So a good example of this is the idea that there's religious violence. The problem with the idea that there's specifically religious violence out there is that there's also economic systems playing here. There is legal codexes that play here. There's, subsistence kind of patterns going on. There's disputes over land rights. You have all kinds of different elements that equate a particular set of circumstances at a particular set of time. So a lot of what holism is realizing that nothing emerges from a vacuum. That
there's a cause and effect element.
Yeah, there's a cause and effect element, and yet there's so many different causes and effects. So much, it's very nuanced. We don't always fully understand it, but anthropologists seek to try to take all the different elements of culture and try to understand a particular situation. And it can be interesting things like, why did we have the rise of Trump and nationalism? Or it could be like, there are women in Sri Lanka who are now working in garment factories and suddenly are experiencing spirit possession. Why is that? So it can be a wide variety of different things. But anthropologists in general, especially cultural anthropologists, have to understand a little bit of everything. So we have to know a little bit about politics, economics, law, religion, gender, race, class, all that stuff I've been listing. And so we take all of that stuff and then we try to understand how culture emerges through these various different competing systems and power dynamics too.
Mm-hmm. And that's cultural relativism.
And cultural relativism is the idea that we should hesitate before judging another culture on our values, right? And so cultural relativism has a little bit of misconfusion. Because a lot of people, especially people who knew about anthropology and don't really care for anthropology, would say like, well, cultural relativism says that, oh, anything can go and it's perfectly acceptable for anyone to do anything just because you say it's cultural. And that's not what we're trying to get at with cultural relativism. What we're saying is that things like, for example, body modification, right? You have tribes who do the neck rings or they do, and of course, now in our culture, we stretch the earlobes too, right? Or tattoos, as I have here, those kind of things we shouldn't judge necessarily based on our cultural lens, but on trying to frame things or see things from their cultural perspective. Why do things matter to people in cultures? That's really the question. Why do people continue to make similar choices and trends in other cultures that are different than our own culture? And if you really want to understand it, and this is something I always tell students, you don't have to like it. You can think it's gross and disgusting, but you have to understand it. Mm. If you don't understand it, then you've lost the point of anthropology. The point is for us to understand the variety of the human experience and cultural relativism says, hold on a second, step back from your judgment for a moment and try to understand why this thing is happening, what its historical roots are, and where is it going into the future. And if we really want to address severe problems, that's the best way to start.
Mm-hmm.
Put aside our judgments and objectively view something the best we can before then diving in. So that's the idea of cultural relativism.
Fantastic. Thank you for that, Michael. I keep wanting to call you Doc because I have so many docs on, but it's coming. It's coming soon, right?
Yeah. I'm in the process of moving into a PhD program.
Fantastic. All right. So then I'll just say, okay, Doc. No, that probably will be insulting to some people, but you have done this series, started this series on race on your YouTube channel on Anthropology in 10 Minutes or Less. And it is just absolutely fascinating. So one of them that I saw talked about the origins of the human family. And everything coming from Africa, and you went into skin color and vitamin K and the sun and the climate and all of these wonderful things that have made up us. Can we start with that? Well, first, before we start with that, let's start with how can people get your channel other than clicking on a link from my channel? How can they get Anthropology in 10 Minutes or Less and tap into this series that you started?
So honestly, the easiest way is to just go onto YouTube and look for Anthropology in 10 or Less. If you type in Anthropology in 10 or Less, it'll pop up right away.
Perfect.
That's just the real simple, easy way of finding the channel. So
that's good SEO too, by the way. Yeah. All right. So why did you decide to start a series on race?
Well, because it is honestly one of the most contentious issues. You know, we talk about a lot of various contentious issues in anthropology, but it is one of those ones that has caused irreparable harm to people. And there are so much misconceptions about it. And, you know, I talked to some of my colleagues here at the University of Colorado at Denver, and we see white supremacists taking their data, their fossil evidence, and various other things and trying to twist it around to kind of prove their ideas of race and racism or the dominance or the superiority of the white race. And so one of the reasons I decided to do a, you know, multi-part series on race was to, first of all, like dispel some of these ideas. Like, you know, everybody seems to have this idea that skin color is just entirely related to how much sun exposure you get. And while that's not necessarily untrue, it's only a small piece of the truth. Hmm. And I think it's important for us to understand that actually skin color in terms of human variation is a relatively arbitrary thing. There is a lot of different elements to human variation that, you know, such as adaptation to high altitude that we don't talk about, or like there's this this one anthropologist who talks about asks the question, like, you know, if we're going to talk about human variation, we're going to use skin color. Why don't we use something like earwax? Because actually earwax has more variation than skin color. And it's just we very arbitrarily choose these categories for very specific reasons. Mm-hmm. And obviously we'll get into that in a little bit, but I wanted to create something that was quick and accessible and clarify, you know, here's the science behind this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And here is how it manifests. Society. And I do have a future episode planned to talk about how race can be very much used as a technology of oppression. And I touched on that a little bit.
Wow, that's a pretty powerful term, a technology
yes.
of oppression. I caught that. You're going to have to unpack that one.
That term, by the way, comes from a scholar by the name of Thomas Bielsi, who did a great article. What was a book chapter, but you can find it on academia.edu. It's just called Race Technologies. And it looks at the difference between the one drop rule in the African-American experience and the blood quantum rule, and how these in the Native American experience, and how these two very different kind of classifications of who is Native American and who is Black have everything to do with economic power and the relationship between, you know, this idea of cultural purity. And by the way, every culture has a concept of purity. And it's as simple as, you know, you should take your shoes off before going into the house, or you shouldn't put your feet up on the table when you're eating. Or it's as complicated as, you know, who is a good white person and who is a bad white person. And we have terms like white trash to talk about those kind of things. So
speaking of which, I got that book by Nancy Eisenberg. I can't put it down.
It's a good, great book. Yeah, yeah, it's fantastic.
Thank you for that. That was a, wow. Okay, I didn't mean to interrupt, but we'll talk about that and unpack that later. But wow, what a book.
Yeah, it's a fantastic book. It's well worth a read. And it's it certainly puts kind of an, you know, a little bit of an ugly spin on some of, you know, the very famous people from history in terms of their treatment of poor people. I mean, it's interesting to see how that dynamic has changed over the course of American history. So definitely worth a read. But yeah, but really ultimately, I started the race series to try to dispel a lot of misconceptions about it. Because I think, honestly, a lot of people just don't understand. You know, they get what they get off of TV, they get what they get off their Facebook page, and they don't necessarily have an opportunity to engage with material that could allow them to really, you know, challenge these concepts. You know,
is it that, or is it just a cultural ignorance or socialization over time?
So an enculturation. And enculturation is this idea that as you grow up and as you engage with a culture, you gain a certain kind of knowledge. And so all cultures have kind of a body of this knowledge. And it's like this big bubble of all the things that are and aren't a part, are supposed to be a part of your culture and all this stuff. And so, yeah, absolutely, socialization is a part of it. But here's the thing. Stereotypes don't come out of nowhere. They come from very long-term engagements, very kind of long-term image-making, and the repetition of different ideas over and over and over again. And there's a great film that illustrates this. Well, there's a couple of great films. The first one, which I believe you can find online for free on YouTube, is called Real Bad Arabs, R-E-E-L, How Hollywood Vilifies a People. And it looks at the past 100 years of Hollywood history and how we've kind of portrayed Arab people, you know. And it shows that these images get recirculated over and over and over again. And those stereotypes, the stereotypes we have today, are very much built out of those long-term conversations that cultures have. You know, these multi-generational conversations about what's a good person to have in society and what's a bad person to have in society, you know, and all those kinds of stereotypes. Another fantastic one is called Real, R-E-E-L again, Injun, On the Trail of the Hollywood Indian. It's a fantastic film about looking, and it's actually quite... It feels lighthearted, even though it's a very heavy topic. The filmmakers did a fantastic job of like looking at how Hollywood portrayed Native Americans throughout history. And they have these different epochs where, you know, early they're savage and then they become like the hippie movement and then like the groovy Indian, you know, all this kind of interesting kind of stuff. So, but the thing is here is that this socialization happens over many generations. And that's why when people do things like civil rights, or of any variety of civil rights, it's a long-term effort. And it's a long-term effort because you have to attack this massive body of knowledge that contains all kinds of abysmal stereotypes. And it takes time to address those various things.
Wow, this is great. So we're looking at a long-term socialization. I don't know if you are familiar with epigenetics. That's a new science that's kind of been around for the last, I guess, 25 years or so, genetic memory, how that plays into this, but then also how it plays into what you call the tech, you know, the technology, the technical aspects of race and racism, and this economic structure in America, and how everything that you were talking about plays into the economic system of America, but it's based upon lies and myths and propaganda socialized over time that does have, I guess, an axiological and epigenetic aspect to it that sticks. And we just come here and start acting out and acting as if these things are true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and to be honest with you, I'm not any expert in epigenetics. I know just the basics, and I know a lot of the, what people are saying now. And there's a lot of back and forth studies right now. I think because we know very little about epigenetics at the moment, that I think it may be a little early to make any definite, concrete assumptions about what epigenetics do. But there is something that it does happen. When something traumatic happens to a person during the course of their life, it does seem to pass on particular phenotypes. So the expression of particular traits in the genetics onto additional generations. And again, I'm not an expert on this, and I wouldn't pretend to be. So maybe there is really great research to document, you know, how, you know, particular historical trauma plays into this. But here, an interesting case study, and for anyone interested, there's a fantastic episode of Radiolab which is a podcast on science out of New York. And it talked about an epigenetic case that was really interesting in Northern Europe, where they found this one village that was they had really, really good ancestry records, like records of how long people lived, how people died. And they looked at over many generations. It also documented times of feast and famine. It documented all kinds of stuff. And interestingly, what they found, and I don't think that they've been able to replicate this anywhere else, but it's in one particular interesting case study, is that if your maternal grandfather went hungry from ages from like 7 to 12, so if they were in a time of famine and they survived that, then their grandchildren would have a much lower risk for diabetes and heart attack and all kinds of stuff. So epigenetics has some really interesting implications, and I think that in the next 20 years, we're going to discover a lot of stuff about epigenetics. But again, I'm no expert in relation to, because I know a lot of my Native American friends that I work with talk about these findings in epigenetics and historical trauma. And for them, I mean, it's not even just historical trauma. Many of them experience that stuff on a daily basis or grew up on reservations where there's abysmal poverty anyway. Mm-hmm. So I think one of the issues between separating epigenetics and, and just trauma from the past versus present is that, you know, a lot of these people who are experiencing this stuff are still experiencing this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, places like Pine Ridge Reservation, for example, the poverty is absolutely abysmal. So, so it's not like that trauma has gone away. And look at mass incarceration and stuff, right?
Sure.
That stuff continues to reassert that same trauma over and over and over again.
So I feel like we're getting ready to go into the second half of the show, and I really want to get back to the first half so we can migrate, because we could talk about this forever, and we probably will. I think you can record up to 4 hours. Anyway, where do humans come from? Where do we come from? We all come from Africa.
We all come out of Africa.
And that has been just, you know, for some people, that's very hard for people to understand and hear. It's like, well, wait a minute. I am, Anglo-Saxon. I am from Europe. I am Japanese. My family's Japanese. I'm Chinese. Wait a minute. How is that even possible that everybody started and came from Africa? Break it down for us.
Well, I mean, we have two things that definitely indicate that we came out of Africa. First is the fossil record. And it's pretty clear that human beings very specifically came out of Africa, particularly, where we look at some of the earliest origins seem to be in areas like where modern day Kenya and Tanzania are. So there's tons of fossil evidence. But really, the crux of this is genetic evidence. There is so little variation across human beings. You know, just because we might look differently on the outside doesn't mean that there's a whole lot of genetic differences between us. We have this, I think it's really easy to look at the very kind of superficial outer features of humans, mm-hmm. and say, well, they're definitely different, right? But in reality, we share, I mean, all humanity shares like the same exact DNA, the same exact genome. You know, there's no significant variation there. And the other thing is too, is at this point, now keep in mind, the fossil record is constantly having to be updated because they're constantly finding new stuff. But the current idea is that we didn't just migrate out of Africa once. So it wasn't like humans just, they started in Africa and then they left. But it looks like there were five different major migration events. And what we mean by major is you're looking at maybe a couple hundred or a couple thousand individuals gradually migrating to other regions in the world. And if you think about it, you know, if you only move a kilometer a year as a group of people, you know, it only takes, you know, a few thousand years for you to get from, you know, the heart of Africa to northern Siberia. And mm-hmm. that you're changing in your location, then you're gradually, things like skin color gradually change, nose shape changes, and nose shape has a lot to do with the amount of humidity in the air. And so these kind of features change as these groups were moving slowly throughout the different parts of the world. And like I said, five major migrations is basically the idea now. Now that doesn't mean that there weren't smaller migrations that travel further, but it's pretty clear that there were five major migration events at least at this particular time. The old idea was that, there's a couple of old ideas. First, that humans evolved separately all over different parts of the world, that, you know, they're different human. There's nothing in genetics that even remotely suggests that that would be the case. The second most popular one was that our ancestor Homo erectus left Africa, about a half a million to 2 million years ago and spread out all over the world, and then Homo erectus evolved in different regions and having different distinct species. But both of those have been completely proven false through genetics. And actually, too, another thing that humans do is they mix all the time and they migrate and they travel all the time. And so we're constantly doing what we call gene flow. So people even, you know, who live in Africa today can end up on the other side of the world. And we like to think of that as a newer thing, that this has only been happening for a couple hundred years. But humans have traveled the world for a long time. And they have gone and basically swapped genes over and over again. A lot of throughout all of history. So.
When we talk about the fossil records, what are we talking about with the first known human coming from Africa?
So there's a little bit of contention on this point, but the oldest fossil we have that appears to be most likely in the human lineage is Sahelanthropus chadensis, and this was a site found in Chad, and that particular group is about 7 to 8 million years ago. And so what we would say is about 7 to 8 million years ago, we have what we call a common ancestor with Sahelanthropus chadensis. Very officially consider a part of the human lineage is Australopithecus afarensis and Australopithecus africanus. And these are both out of, again, like that Rift Valley region. In what we would consider modern Tanzania. Lucy, if you've ever heard of the fossil Lucy, she was one of these groups. And
great propaganda film, too, by the way.
Lucy?
Yeah, Lucy, the movie.
I'm not familiar with
it. With, Morgan Freeman was in that, and Scarlett Johansson played Lucy.
Oh, that one, yes.
Yeah, I thought that was absolutely hilarious. I'm like, really? Honestly, that's what you want to kind of, okay, fine, go ahead.
Lucy, who is, by the way, named after the Beatles song, Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, they were listening to it when they discovered her. But she's about...
I didn't know that history. Okay, great. All right.
It's a great story, and there's plenty of information websites out there on her discovery. The Australopithecines, and there's a number of different ones, we consider them firmly in the human ancestry. And then, of course, we get to what we call the Homo groups, which include Homo habilis, Homo ergaster, Homo erectus. a variety of different ones that were much closer to human beings.
What time frame are we in now?
So those are all very different time frames. So
yeah.
But you're ranging, when you talk about the rise of the genus Homo, you're talking about 2 million years to the past to present. So we have about 2 million to present is the genus Homo. And obviously the final incarnation is Homo sapiens, which is us. We see the earliest humans, and again, this is a little bit, there's a little bit of debate on exactly the exact dates, but somewhere between 150 to 250,000 years ago, we see the first, what we consider modern humans. When we really are modern is about 50,000 years ago. And it appears to us at this moment in time that language in the way that we think of it was not possible until about 50,000 years ago. And so really kind of mark like, okay, this is the time when, we have the modern human being. So,
and when we talk about language, we're not talking about English. We're talking about just language and linguistics. That ancient, like you were talking about those ancient linguistics, because most people say, "Oh, okay, well, we started speaking English 50,000 years ago." No.
I mean, English is a relatively recent language, and it's a mix between several languages that and largely based in Germanic language, but. We're talking about kind of modern cognition and grammar were available about 50,000 years ago. And by the way, I'm telling you this stuff, but there's always new finds and there's always new ideas. And so like I might say this stuff and a new find comes out tomorrow that says, okay, look, it was 40,000 years ago or it was 60,000 years ago. And so paleoanthropologists in particular have to kind of we recognize that, we always have to re-examine ourselves because there's always new evidence coming into that.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing, too, is that language has a long evolution. And we see some...
What do you mean by that?
We see some indications that it took a long time for language to emerge, that there was several different groups before modern humans that did language, but we don't know exactly what that looks like because... we only have, for example, we can look at the throat, the remains of like throats, muscles, and bones, and those kind of things. What kind of muscles and bones were in what places at what time? Because if you we see the Planet of the Apes movies, and there's like a new one coming out, I guess, this summer. They're speaking, but actually, they don't have the physical apparatus to speak. So it's not even just a brain problem. It's the fact that they don't have the right muscles, they don't have the right bones, like the hyoid bone, in order to do speech. So, but we see, when we look at the fossil records, in particular with Homo heidelbergensis, which was about 400,000 to 200,000 years ago, and Neanderthalensis, which is around the same period, but goes all the way to extend about 40,000 years ago, we see a gradual change in the way that these muscle structures have changed and what kind of bones are present. And so we can see that their language was forming over a long period. It wasn't something just happened, all of a sudden we have language and consciousness. It appears to be that it was something that gradually happened over time.
Wow, that's fascinating. You mentioned earlier, which was really interesting, was fascinating that it wasn't just as a result of climate conditions, altitude conditions that change skin color, but also features. Mm-hmm. Speak to us about that. So people would say, like, how did people become Chinese and or Asian and where do white people? We know where white people came from. That's an American construct. But where do Europeans come from? How did an African become a European over time? What are all of those variables that happen over time in terms of skin color, and why is vitamin K and the sun so relevant in the conversation and in the study and research?
It's actually more specifically two things: vitamin D and folic acid. Those are the two really.
I'm sorry. Would I say vitamin K? I meant vitamin D. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Those are the in terms of skin color. Those are the two big ones. What we see is that you know, whenever there's a change that occurs in people's, you know, both genetics and phenotypes, the genetic expression, there has to be some sort of environmental selective pressure. It's not just like, oh, I want to be stronger, and so I'm going to get stronger over time by pumping iron or something like that, right? It doesn't happen like that. So when it comes to skin color and other features, we tried, and we don't know everything about all the features, but skin color is one of those ones that we definitely know a lot about. But like skin color in general, we see when you have too little vitamin D in your system, you get what we call brittle bone syndrome, or in the case of children, rickets. And so, in fact, in the early 20th century, there were huge cases of rickets all throughout the United States and England and Europe, especially children who were born with darker skin. And, you know, a lot of children died. Over about a decade or two of research, scientists figured out that there was a lack of vitamin D in their system. And so that's why we got vitamin D fortified foods. But the number one way we get vitamin D is through UVB radiation. So UVB radiation hits our skin, and it triggers the synthesis of vitamin D within our system. Mm. And so it's not only children with rickets, but it can also cause things like birth defects. And same with folic acid. Folic acid is, I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself here. But so basically, skin color is an adaptation depending on how much sunlight you would get, your ancestors would get. And so if you got too much, you would get too much sunlight, you would produce too much folic acid, and then you would have things like microencephalia, the large or messed up or brain sizes, or you would. So in other words, you would have a lot of like very debilitating disorders, and it also could impact. So in other words, you can't reproduce very well. Like, mm-hmm. Especially if you're talking about an era 10, 20, 30,000 years ago, we don't have modern medicine. You don't do very well if you're born with a birth defect, and so. So the changing of the level of melanin in your skin had everything to do with how much sunlight you would get to synthesize too much or too little of your particular vitamins.
Wow.
So if you go up and you're in Europe and you're not getting enough, then people with lighter skin are much better at synthesizing vitamin D because they have to be. Because if you go to a place like England where it rains 9 months out of the year, you don't get a lot of sunlight. So you need to synthesize everything you can. Dark skin are not as adept at synthesizing vitamin D from sunlight, but that's because then they risk getting too much sun. And also things like your sweat glands get damaged if you get too much sun over time. There's all kinds of various interesting things that have to do with skin color. But the real point here is that skin color is nothing more than a biological defense mechanism against, solar radiation. So it was a selection to make sure that your body got the appropriate amount. It's basically all it was.
Fantastic. So can you walk us through this? I had Dr. Edwin Nichols on, who's a axiologist and leading philosopher, and he talked about the journey of the Eurasian and having coming from the effects of the Ice Age. Mm-hmm. And what that did to a human's body, mm-hmm. over thousands of years, no sun, unbelievably sub-below temperatures. And as you talked about earlier, food. Mm-hmm. They only had 3 months out of the year to eat and grow the crops and create the crops so that they could. And so they became very object-oriented as a result, controlling of the resources for that population to survive is the reason why. Where does your study of anthropology come in with what we call the children of the ice?
You know, honestly, I'm not as familiar with that particular population or that particular history. I will say that we do, in physical anthropology, they talk about a couple of things, Bergman's rule and Allen's rule. And both these basically say that, and this is not just in humans, but animals too, that people in hotter, drier climates tend to be taller and skinnier. And so they have less surface area of their body to deal with, to be able to give off more heat. And then when you look at northern populations, or you look at these people in like the Arctic, they tend to be shorter and rounder. And not just people, but also animals. Because you think of a penguin, right? So they tend to have more, they tend to be shorter and squatter, so then that way they can conserve heat, you know, in particular populations. Certainly also the other thing I would ask you is what particular time period, was this individual referring to?
I think it's the last glaciation, the worm, glaciation.
Okay.
You can elaborate on that if you have any information on that to confirm or to approve it or not confirm it.
Yeah. You know, and again, my area of specialty is cultural anthropology. So
right. Right.
I'm not as knowledgeable on that stuff. So. Yeah, so he obviously probably spoke better to it on the subject than I could have.
So. Okay, good to know. All right, so we kind of know now where we come from. We know how skin color came about. Let's talk about genetics, mm-hmm. right? Because you say we're genetically pretty much the same, but what is it that makes a person Chinese versus African versus Eurasian or Caucasian? What are those variables? And then let's get into these labels and how we come to America and create these labels.
Okay, so I mean, first of all, a lot of what humans deal with is environmental conditions. A lot of the adaptations that we have in our physical features are directly proportional in relation to our ancestors and how the environment impacted us in various ways. So a really interesting—
Can you give us an example? Yeah, I was gonna say, can you give us an example? Sure.
So here's the thing. Humans are actually very plastic. We actually adapt fairly quickly. So in the early 20th century, late 19th century, there was this idea that you could, you know, measure people's heads and find out what, you know, race they were and what were their kind of, you know, we had something called the cephalic index where, like, you know, here's the good head shape and here's the bad head shape. And, you know, and we would look at, oh, certain immigrant populations have certain kinds of head shapes and those kind of things. And the guy by the name of Franz Boas, who in anthropology we talk about as he's basically the father of American anthropology. He invented the four fields kind of rewrote the book on anthropology, what anthropology is and should do. He questioned this. Now, this is a man, by the way, who was forced out of Germany because he was Jewish and came to the United States because of oppression. And accidentally kind of stumbled on anthropology. He was a physicist that stumbled on anthropology accidentally and fell in love with it. And so here was a man who said, okay, if you're really going to make that claim, let's prove it. If this is a real thing, let's test that idea. So he went to New York, specifically Ellis Island, and he measured 18,000 immigrants and their children. Looking at their head size and shape. And what he noticed is that even in just one or two generations, human variation began to kick in because of environmental conditions. So head sizes and shapes began to change actually within a generation or two. It was kind of this amazing discovery because it just showed that, you know, all these characteristics we have as human are very much tied into, you know, what are environmental conditions. Another example for you is high altitude adaptations. And what we see in places like the Andean mountains where people live, you know, at 11, 12, 13,000 feet, we see that they have a tendency to have larger lung capacities and bigger chests. But the really interesting thing is if they go down to altitude, so they go down to sea level and then have children, those children will not have those same lung capacities. So what you actually see is that, you know, there's a case of epigenetics, right? So you have things getting switched on and switched off. And a lot of the physical characteristics of humans are directly impacted by environmental conditions more than anything. So,
wow, that's good stuff. That is good stuff. Okay, so then let's now talk about, I guess, the technical aspects of race and racism as it relates to America, which is how I found out about you. As I said, I've had Dr. Jacqueline Battaglia on several times, and I was, you know, fascinated by the fact that just the term white people was completely fabricated and invented, and that in historical references, no reference of a European ever referring to themselves as white. And so she unpacked Bacon's Rebellion, what have you. Give us your anthropological perspective on that. And how white people were invented and what that meant and what that did culturally to both the newly classified white and the people of color, Africans and Indian people of that descent.
Yeah, so I mean, obviously Dr. Battaglia could talk about this in way more great detail than me, but I'll say this, you have a number of uprisings, and Bacon Rebellion is kind of the keystone of all this, but you have a number of kind of class uprisings because the conditions of the colonists were pretty poor, with a few exceptions. You had a lot of favoritism going on with people like the king, who was saying, hey, my buddy's coming into town, I'm going to give him this big swath of land. And people who had indentured contracts were supposed to receive, you know, a certain amount of land, and they were guaranteed all kinds of rights. Before these rebellions, we see black African descendant people having just as much rights as white people. There were free blacks in America. And this is a fact that is largely ignored by high school textbooks, that there was a particular moment when all of a sudden being black meant slavery. Before it hadn't necessarily meant that. Of course, you have African traders who came from Africa, who lived in the colonies, who went back and forth from the colonies, who themselves also participated in trade, slave trade, everyone had the right to vote. But then you start to see a lot of conflicts because there's a number of reasons that there was conflicts. First and foremost is the fact is that we're colonizing this land, and there's people already here, right? There's already Native Americans here. And so—
What, you mean Christopher Columbus didn't discover America? Oh my gosh, what happened here? I have to change my show.
Yeah, I mean, what's really funny about it is he didn't even make it to the mainland, right? He only made it to the island. So, don't get me
started. Talk about changing the history books and for the kids, right? Okay.
Yeah. Sorry, I lost my train of thought here. Part of what was happening is you see these indentured populations, you know, being brought in to do the labor to, you know, continue this huge amount of wealth for these property owners, right? And the property owners began to quickly realize that they can't just expand out forever, that there was kind of a limit to this expansion. So they started saying, you know, okay, you finished your indentured contract. We don't have any land for you. I don't know what to say. Or they would, someone would steal a loaf of bread and suddenly, you know, 5 years was added onto their indentured contract or, you know, various other things. So it created a kind of crisis, because the Native Americans, and were rightfully so, not really willing for, you know, these colonists to be pushing out forward, further and further. Eventually, obviously, they did, and they had to use the military to kind of, you know, push back these populations. But so what you had was a situation of, you know, scarcity and the living conditions worsened and worsened. And then, of course, what happens whenever, you know, people get so oppressed that they get fed up, is there's a peasant revolt, basically, right? And we see this all throughout history, where when poor people get oppressed enough, they've had enough, and there's a revolution. Mm-hmm. And the particular revolution that triggered everything here was Bacon's Rebellion. And Bacon, by the way, was, you know, he was a piece of work himself.
He wasn't a good guy.
He wasn't a good guy. Basically, he wanted land for himself, and he wanted to use the local militia to take that land away from Native Americans. And the local administrators and government basically said, no, we're not going to do that. You don't get land. And so what he started doing was going to the, you know, the free blacks, going to the slaves and promising them freedom if they help him out, which he had absolutely no intention of keeping. And the indentured servants, and he basically rounded up all these people, and over the course of the year got them really pissed off and angry, and finally Jamestown burns, you know. And William Buckley, who was the governor at the time, had to flee, and he came back later with a whole bunch of British troops and retook the city and took back over. But, you know, these landlords and, you know, these people who were working in the government and in the legal system at the time realized this is going to keep happening. We can't keep doing what we're doing and get away with it.
Mm-hmm. So, this is, we have to kind of put it in context for today. This is the 1% talking.
Yes, totally. 1% talking. The 1% is like, wait a second. We're not going to be able to remain the 1% because they're going to keep rising up against us. So what you see, and this is really the crux of Dr. Badalora's work, is she looked at the legal codexes, and suddenly you get the creation of particular categories of white and dark skin. And over the course of a couple of decades, these laws get more and more specific. You know, and it starts really anti-miscegenation laws. It starts with the idea that if you're dark skinned, you can't marry a light skinned, you know, woman. And there was a kind of a marriage crisis in that era too, by the way. There were so many men and so few women. So
yeah, they used to have to ship women in from England.
Yeah.
To marry. That's how bad it was. If you can imagine, they had to ship women in to marry because it was more men, and it was just not enough.
Yeah. So if you have a sizable portion of your population is darker skinned, and you're also trying to wedge a division between the poor whites and the poor darker skinned people, here's a good way to start. So, you know, you get that these first laws in the books in the early 1680s. But by the time we get to 100 years later, we see not only it's, so this gets back into when we were talking earlier about those long-term portrayals, right?
Mm-hmm.
What happens is suddenly they created this idea that if you're light-skinned, even if you're poor, you have something in common with the wealthy elite. And that was the idea. Get the whites to all think, get these lighter-skinned people to all think that they have something in common with us, and then they will, and give them policing power over the dark-skinned people, and you can get them to fight each other forever. And what better way to control a populace than to get it to fight amongst itself? That's just the easiest.
Which
way.
Completely takes all of the onus and eyeballs off of the 1% for them to do whatever it is that they want to do, because the fight is over here between this made up label that became law, unfortunately, and here we are. And so we can kind of see that today. In this new administration, and why so many, I like what you say, all these light people said, hey, you know what, I'm going to go and vote for this guy, but this guy has nothing in common with you other than skin color, because you didn't get a new job, you didn't get a raise, and you're not staying at Mar-a-Lago. So here we are, doing the same thing again and again and again. These are the epigenetics, but these laws is what ushered in chattel slavery, and when everything really became catastrophic to humanity in America. Continue to walk us through that. And I think you also have some shows coming up talking about Darwinism and the eugenics, you know, how some anthropologists, you know, worked in eugenics and all of this falsification of race, genetics, and class. Walk us through some of that minefield, if you will, as we come out to now.
So, you know, we have about 100 years of these laws and legal codexes, right? And then along comes a man by the name of Carlinus Linnaeus. And Linnaeus is, by the way, a super important person in science, especially biology, because what he did was take classifications and made them uniform for various different animal species. But when he was done with animal species, he said, let's do humans. And his first initial classifications, you know, had four main classifications of humans. You had Europeans, Africans, Asians, and Native Americans. Those are basically his four categories. And on the show, I go into detail about like some of the qualities that he attributes to those. And of course, only the white people had the good qualities. You know, everyone else was, dangerous or greedy or, you know, those kind of things. But the white people, they were, you know, sanguine and muscular and beautiful and, you know, all this stuff, of course. Because, of course, Linnaeus himself is a dude from Europe. So
Right. So that was completely a blue sky.
Yeah, so exactly. So this is where you see the beginning of what we call scientific racism. And this, you know, you get a whole bunch of things like the eugenics movement, which, you know, to sum up real quick, is basically the idea that there is a pure human being that you can somehow breed, that there's this perfect kind of intelligent and hardworking individual that you can kind of get to. And of course, the ultimate eugenicist was Hitler. So blonde hair, blue eyes, Aryan race, all that stuff, right? So Hitler is where the eugenics movement kind of came to a head, as it were, and the Holocaust, horrible results of this 150 or so, 250 so years of this eugenics idea, this idea of there are some humans that are superior to others. And by the way, too, this wasn't just a skin color thing. The eugenics movement also included poverty. So if you were poor, if you were apt to drink, if you behaved in any kind of criminal way, you were said to have some kind of physical type. In the early days, some anthropologists participated in this. So it is an anthropologist. I love anthropology so much, but it has a very dark history in some cases. In fact, anthropology was originally kind of used to, pacify indigenous people for colonial rule, because actually it's quite expensive to just go and do massacre after massacre and wipe people out. So much better if you can make them kind of just give in and assimilate to your colonial rule. So anthropologists, actually, their earliest origins, and by the way, this is why there's a lot of group who still to this day distrust or mistrust anthropologists, is because there's this very ugly history with anthropology that it's really important that anthropologists don't deny it. And science in general, like there was a lot of racist science. Now, I will say that it was both, you know, science, genetics, and anthropologists who ultimately disproved all this stuff that showed that race was a social construct, but they certainly played their part in the early days. Boaz, for example, was a very interesting individual. And what you see is, you see a lot of these individuals who mean very well, who do some things that are very questionable because they think what they're, you know, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. So we talked about Boaz as disproving this whole, you know, you have a brain size thing that demonstrates, you know, if you're a good or bad person. And he was specifically trying to address the eugenics movement, saying like, look, there's not a type here. And what he also discovered, by the way, was that there is more variation between individuals within a group than across groups. So what you see is you have a group of white people, there's more variation in the white people than if you take a group of white people and black people. And same thing on the other side. There's more variation in the black people than there are between the two groups. So the most variation is individualistic. That's most of where human variation is. It varies from one person to the next. Because we're all kind of like genetic evolutionary experiments, you know, who does to see who does, who succeeds to reproduce, essentially. But Boaz also participated in something that's really ugly called human zoos. And now Boaz's justification, and I'm totally not justifying it for him, but his justification was that if we take indigenous people and we put them on display in places like the World's Fair, then people will come to understand them and they won't look at them in stereotypical ways. But the result was the exact opposite. And not only that, there were some horrible cases, such as in like Germany and France, when they did like African exhibits where they put African animals in with the humans, and you can imagine what kind of all kinds of awful stuff went on there with, you know, lions and things. There was endless cases of prostitution rings surrounding these kind of institutions. They were a horribly, horribly ugly institution. And most of the World's Fairs had them. We tend to think of the World's Fair and history as these great, like, innovation and science and what's the world doing. And, you know, it brought people together. You also had human zoos at those places. And, you know, and a lot of what went on too was really trying to find a kind of racial typology between people. And part of this was ignorance. Part of this was the fact that we didn't understand genetics yet. That it wasn't until we discovered DNA, you know, in the 1950s that we really understood the nature of genetics, that actually the outward expression of what we look like doesn't make that much of a difference in terms of genetics. So there was all these kinds of institutions, and when it finally, we kind of mark the one particular book and one particular date as kind of the end of this stuff. It had been kind of ending for a while. We had Boaz, who, by the way, worked very diligently with people like W.E.B. Du Bois to create new types of thinking about, you know, what is this race idea anyway, and challenge a lot of this nationalism and challenge a lot of these ideologies that were horribly damaging to people's lives. In fact, those two together hosted several major academic conferences together and worked on a number of issues together. But what we see is the final kind of, the place where anthropologists and scientists in general took a stand is in 1962. And you see there was a physical anthropologist by the name of Carlton S. Kuhn. And Carlton S. Kuhn published a book called The Races of Man, where he took, at that time, every fossil available on the origins of humans. It was like a 472 pages, I believe, on just fossil records, and no analysis, no nothing, just very detailed sketches. The problem was the other several hundred pages of his text, where he basically argued that humans evolved five different times. What happened was as a whole, essentially the scientific community, Kuhn also denied that he was trying to do anything to help the segregationist movement, but it turns out he was helping people like Carl Putnam make pamphlets on, you know, why we should segregate and all this kind of nonsense. That came out much later in his life, but he denied this idea that he, he's like, I was just trying to do good science. But actually what happened is we had geneticists come out and talk about, Theodosius Dobrzynski, who is a very famous geneticist, looking at, in terms of human relationships and stuff. We had a number of other biological anthropologists look at this fossil record and saying, you know, you're interpreting what you want to see. We can very easily say, like, this is not, what we see here is not true. your interpretation, your fossil details are good, but your interpretation is way off. And they gave a number of reasons why this was not the case. And so 1962 was kind of the end of this time when anthropologists couldn't take a stand against this particular kind of thinking. And we had to kind of disregard that all that other stuff that came before, eugenics, the idea of racial superiority, all that stuff was very much pseudoscience. And by the way, the sad thing is this isn't done. We still have people pushing these ideas. And the new current one is that, so we now know that human beings, so Homo sapiens, had at least several major interbreeding events with Neanderthals in Europe. And so we actually share 4 or 5%, most humans share 4 or 5% of Neanderthal DNA. That DNA is more highly concentrated in Europe just because of regional variation, but it is spread out throughout most of the human population. But what we see now is white supremacists taking these ideas and saying, well, it's the fact that we interbred with Neanderthals that makes white superior, which is really funny because 15 years ago, those same people were appalled at the idea of, you know, humans interbreeding with Neanderthals. Now the estimate is that there were actually 4 different groups we interbred with based on genetic evidence. We only know of 2. That we most likely interbred with, but Neanderthals is one of them. And so we, but again, it's proof texting. You're taking small pieces of data and research out of the context of the wider argument, and you're using it to prove your ideas, mm-hmm. right? Instead of actually, and a lot of these things too are also because people just don't know how to read data. They don't know how to interpret this information, and so they what happens when you don't understand something? You take your own experiences, your own ideas, and you press mm-hmm. upon it to try to understand it. I mean, that's a natural human thing to do.
Sure.
But when it comes to situations of power where we're trying to justify a neo-segregation movement, and that's apparently a thing now, I've also been personally accused after posting one of my episodes of being an advocate for white genocide. Which I was like, a white what?
So, there's a term that I saw, Dr. Joy DeGruy sent it to me. It said that, it says, diversity equals white genocide.
Yeah, there's like this huge movement that, like, I mean, this of course is with along the lines of, you know, Richard Spencer, I mean, who calls himself a white nationalist, but I mean, let's be clear, he's not. That's what he is. The term white nationalist is like a foo-foo way of saying, you know, I'm a white supremacist, that I care only about, you know, the supremacy of the white, white people and stuff. And of course, as we've been talking about, like, the funny thing is, there's a couple of funny things about this. First of all, who is white has changed throughout history. Because for the longest time, the only people who are white were Anglo-Saxons. So people of English descent, and some French, but for the most part, Germans were not white, Irish were not white, Italians were not white, Russians were not white, and so on and so forth.
A lot of people don't know that, though.
Yes.
A lot of people don't know that, because we all now say all white people are, you know, European, whatever.
Right.
But yeah, there was a specificity to the label creation of white.
And also, the other thing about it was that there were lynch mobs for Irish and Italians who lynched Irish and Italian people for, you know, getting near their daughter and things like that. So there, you know, there was a horrible term for Irish in the mid-1800s was Negroes turned inside out.
And also the book White Trash.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. And it's really important to understand that who is white and who isn't has not only was it a created category, but that it's changed throughout all of history. Like it's never been kind of a static thing, and it's directly related to the control of power, which again, when Thomas Bielski talks about race as a technology, he talks about how In some cases, we allow for groups to mix. And in this case, you talk about Native Americans. It was very much encouraged for white people to mix with Native Americans, for example, because Native Americans had land. And if you mix them, then you can get that land. Whereas, you know, former African slaves had nothing. And so what they wanted to do was keep them out of the economic zone so that they don't compete with other whites.
Mm-hmm.
So you have the creation of, in Plessy versus Ferguson, with the one drop rule. And then, of course, you have Minnesota based versus St. Cloud with the creation, the first initial criteria for what it means to be Native American. You know, and then suddenly some people overnight who had been their whole life Native American were no longer considered Native American.
Mm-hmm.
We also saw another round of this in the 1950s with something called the Federal Termination Policy, where after the during and after the Second World War, the American government tried to get rid of all Native American reservations and turn them over to state jurisdiction. And there were some cases overnight where literally their legal category of being Native American was destroyed. So that way they, so at least legally, they were no longer considered Native American. So talk about like a shock to your identity.
Yeah, no question about it. Yeah, it's like me tomorrow morning, I wake up and I'm supposed to be Italian.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, really? Okay. Well, there's a couple of people I need to off really quick. Let's go down and get Bam Bam Bozzino and come down here. Yeah, but that's how these laws, people, you know, I was just watching 60 Minutes last night, and they were just talking about the executive order that Trump did to remove illegal aliens. It was this gentleman, it was a heartbreaking story. He's been here 20 some odd years, got a huge family, a great family. He was in Indianapolis, had a wonderful restaurant. It was kind of like the Cheers of the neighborhood. And he got deported after being here 20 years. He's not a criminal, never had a speeding ticket. But because of the laws and how imperfect these laws are, he now might not be able to get back into this country for another 4 years or another 20 years if that extension doesn't work. That's how sick and demented these laws are. Go ahead.
It gets so much worse, because here's the thing. Anyone who tells you they want to solve the immigration crisis, it's total bullshit. Total bullshit.
Okay.
There is money to be made bringing undocumented workers in, because there are tons of companies that love to hire them for low wages. There's also a significant problem of wage theft in this country, which, you know, is basically slavery. You have someone work for you for 4 or 5 months and then you don't pay them.
Mm-hmm.
So you have a lot of that. There's a lot of money to be made bringing them in as cheap and or free labor. There's a ton of money to be made deporting them. And border security and the military industrialization of the border. There's also a ton of money to be made in putting them in prison. In fact, here in Aurora, we have a prison hosted by Geo Group. It's a for-profit prison that is paid $160 a day to hold immigrants, and they're traded on the stock market. So they have every incentive in the world to make sure those beds are filled, always filled. And there's been all kinds of corruption scandals. There was one in Pennsylvania where the judge was apparently, you know, sending people specifically to the for-profit prisons for extra money and all kinds of ugly stuff. So all these people who talk about how they need to come and do this stuff legally, no one really wants them to come legally, because then they're protected. It is another way of creating another class divide. These people, they become very they put themselves in a precarious situation because they're absolutely desperate, and we take advantage of that. And there are several major industries in this country that absolutely benefit from having undocumented workers on our soil and have no desire to really to solve the issue.
It wouldn't be into the economic benefit to do so.
Yeah, exactly. So, but that's a whole other thing, and there's a whole discussion. We could talk a whole day on that stuff. But I don't know if you heard of her, Jeanette Vizcuera. Jeanette is the mom here in Denver who took refuge in a sanctuary in a church here in Denver because they were trying to basically deport her away from her family. She's been fighting the system for years now. through very legal means, and just everything. She's done everything she's supposed to do, but she violated her agreement once because her mom was dying of cancer and she wanted to say goodbye. So she crossed over to the border, and that has since then created all kinds of problems for her. So she actually is a part of the social justice theater troupe that I worked with for my master's research. I know her and her situation personally, and it is an unbelievably sad story. We so often forget in these conversations about any of this stuff that these are human beings that we're dealing with. We're not dealing with, it's real easy when you look at someone on the news, they're far away, and you don't know who they are, to kind of dissociate with them. But these are real human beings who, bleed the same way we do, suffer the same way we do. And I think that's a very real thing that we have to think about and acknowledge.
So. I appreciate that. Thank you for sharing that. Winding down, when we were on the phone, I was telling you that I had Rachel Dolezal on. Mm-hmm. And Rachel, of course, really shook up the world. Mm-hmm. As she was outed by her parents as a white woman posing, if you will, as a black woman, and going as far and saying, hey, I'm not even posing, I'm identifying as a black woman versus an African American. Walk us through some level of cultural, anthropological, give me some big words and some little words and put all of that stuff together to try to make sense of this shit. I am so crazy right now, I don't know what to do. I love her to death, I've talked to her on the phone, she's a sweetheart of a gal. Highly respect what she's done with the NAACP, she's done amazing work. And I can see where she has been able to do some work as a quote unquote light-skinned black woman that she might not have been able to do as a, unfortunately, white woman or a dark-skinned black woman. This is the world we live in. Unfortunately, it's real. We're trying to work through it and around it and circumvent it, but here we are, and this as they say, this shit is real. Walk us through some kind of aspect of what is it to, can you identify as black? We know that the only genetic aspect of this is melanin.
Yeah, so I mean, this is a really interesting question, and I don't know that there are any real easy answers for this particular topic.
You have to have an answer because you're Michael Kilman.
But here's the thing. So when we talk about identity, there's kind of two aspects to it, right? There is there's self-selection, and there's also social attribution, right? So here's the thing, and the problem with talking about trans racism or transracial. The problem is that race is not a chosen identity, it's a conferred identity. And so, I totally see where she is saying, like, yeah, there were some things she may not have been able to do as a white person. But at the same time, she also, there's kind of an element of privilege here, right? That she could just take off that guise at the end of the day and proceed as white. And this is, again, not to demonize her or anything like that. But the problem is that if we're going to talk about race, we have to understand that it was socially attributed to people for a very specific reason. And that very specific reason has to do with oppression. Now, it wasn't a choice that people made. And there's a whole bunch of what we call implicit bias or subconscious knowledge about the way people look and the way people are treated and those kinds of things, right? So all that's built all the way back to when we're talking about Bacon's Rebellion. This mm-hmm. stuff all goes back to that kind of particular idea that we suddenly have created these categories. So what you have in this particular case is a woman who was in a superior position in society who used kind of a different identity to gain particular advantages. Now, I don't honestly know enough about her and her actions. I know she was involved with NAACP and some other organizations that did some good work for dealing with some issues. So it's not to say that her intentions were not good, that she wasn't doing what she's supposed to do. But we actually, this ties into a larger white identity crisis that we have in this country.
Never heard of that, a white identity crisis.
White identity crisis. What we have, and this is, and I mentioned to you on the phone, anthropologist John Hartigan, right? Mm-hmm. He focuses on the construction of whiteness because we always talk about race.
And that's also Badalora's work too, yeah.
Yes. We always talk about race, but we never talk about white race, right? Unless we're talking about supremacy. But we never analyze white people the same way we do other groups. And it's really important to talk about the fact that there is, you know, if we're going to talk, you know, the other thing here too is that when you have anyone of darker skin do something, like do something bad and it comes up on the media, what do they say? They say the black community must hold these people accountable. They can't be doing that. But then you'll see, someone going in and shooting up a church in Charleston. They don't talk about, they talk about this person as a lone wolf. So we see white people are considered individuals. They're considered to have individual choices. Their mistakes are their own. But if you talk about minority populations, they're a part of community. And the entire community is at fault for their failures, right? So so a lot of what you have here is there's a bit of an identity crisis in whiteness because the way that we talk about whiteness in general society, it is invisible. It doesn't appear anywhere. And so that's why you see a lot of things like cultural appropriation, where people are trying to find themselves through identity by dressing up in various ways. And in this particular individual's case, where you have them trying to find an identity. And they're not, I don't believe that most cultural appropriation is out of malice. I believe the vast majority of it is people trying to legitimately understand their place in the world. But when we treat whiteness as invisible, as not real, as having no centralized community, then we find people who are white who struggle with their identity, who, and they may turn to this in various ways. They may turn to religion and say, okay, I have a Christian or a Muslim or a Buddhist identity. That's where they put it. Or they may do things like cultural appropriation, where they go to Coachella and dress up in these horribly inappropriate costumes because they're trying to embody something. There's a lot of what we call white fragmentation too, where you have, we have what, so even in whiteness, there is an ideal white, right? And that ideal white is basically what the congressman looks like. If they're wealthy, they're upper class, they have access to all these privileges in societies, you know, they have these huge penthouses and cities and those kind of things. And then we have, you know, people living in trailers. And we call them white trash. And what they actually are is, more than anything, a scapegoat for the operation of a structural violence and structural racism. So what you get is the wealthy whites who basically create the circumstances across the different groups and kind of muck up all of this stuff and create a very severe system of oppression, then turn and point to the people in the trailer parks and say, hey, you guys are the racists. You're the one that are causing the problem. It's not me. I have nothing to do with this stuff. Those people are the ones who are just trying to navigate their lives day to day. And of course, this of course is what leads to the rise of things like nationalism, right? Where you get, or Trumpism, or whatever you want to call, or we have the rise of nationalism again in Europe, and we had that very close call election the other night in France too.
Sure.
We see the rise of this nationalism, and of course, the ultimate term here is white nationalism. But all of this is in response to the creation of massive inequality. And so white identity is, I know it may have seemed like I kind of went away there, but all of, because in anthropology, we tend to look at things holistically. All of this stuff is interrelated. All of this stuff has to do with, the disenfranchising of poor whites who then feel like they have no identity, no culture, and then seek out other groups' identity and culture to try to cling on to something. Because, you know, minorities may be oppressed, but to the white person who is themselves oppressed, who lives in in very squalid poverty, in very really difficult situations, they see what they see a community of, you know, African-American community. They see a Native American community, and they say, you know, they might be oppressed, but they have each other. Who do I have? And so that's what a lot of cultural appropriation kind of comes from. So, and of course,
That's interesting. So as a result of that, you can see then where the classism and racism now makes sense.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Fascinating. Thank you for unpacking that. So the poor white person is saying, I have really nowhere to go because I'm not part of, even though it's fascinating because we're looking at it and say, yeah, you're part of a group, you're all white. But we're classified, you know, as a group. Native Americans are classified as a group, you know, Hispanics are classified as a group. But here we go back to that individualistic aspect of identity, particularly a poor white person. And so they say, okay, well, you know what, I'm going to vote for Trump because maybe he'll look out for the little guy. I have something in common with him from maybe a class issue, even though I'll never be a billionaire. But, you know, those guys over there never accept me.
Yeah, and what is a Trump rally? It's group identification, right? And not just a Trump rally, by the way. All political parties are very much about group identification and working together in community and those kind of things, right? So here you see a bunch of people who, and we saw this too with the Democratic Party with Bernie Sanders, not Trump, right? Where we see a bunch of people who have been really raked over by neoliberalism, by this idea of the deregulation of capitalism so that the 1% can do whatever the hell they want. And why we see the rise of nationalism is a reaction to this global neoliberal capitalism. And all that stuff messes with people's identity and makes them feel disenfranchised. And so you saw a lot of angry voters go for either Trump or Bernie Sanders. Now, obviously, they had different platforms, different ideas for how to address the issues that are going on. But both cases, we're talking about people who were disenfranchised voters who felt like the established system was not working.
Fascinating. Why did you, you said when we were talking, it's like, you said, wow, Trump won, son of a bitch. Why? Stupid ass question. Why ask why? You should know. But why did you feel that way about Trump? And as an anthropologist and as a person who is labeled a white person, why did you not feel a connection or an association with Donald Trump versus a Sanders versus a Hillary versus all the people who were running?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of reasons, right? But a lot of what Trump embodies is kind of short-sighted nationalism. You know, make America great again. And it's not to say that we shouldn't make America great again, but we also have to understand that for a lot of people, America wasn't so great.
The question for us is, when was it ever?
Right.
Other than post, pre-anti-miscegenation, perhaps.
Right.
Which most people is almost like, you know, myth-making. It's like, it's unfathomable.
It is. I mean, every nation has a myth. We all have a national mythology, right? And those are very specifically crafted through various parts of history for various reasons. By people who are in power or who control a lot of the power, right? I mean, this is straight out of, you know, not to get all conspiracy theory-esque, but this is straight out of Orwell, right? Those who control the past control the future. Those who control the present control the past. Absolutely true. Think about the fact that we don't talk about that there were free blacks before there was slavery. Before, not necessarily before there was slavery, but before there were different concepts of black versus white. You know, so what I see, I also see a lot of like anger and a short-sightedness in our president. I see a lot of, and it's not even to say that I'm by no means saying that all the people who supported him were racist or bigots or anything like that. I think that's a gross oversimplification. I think he is a master of caricature. Like, you can really embody, you know, that the anger that people want to see and they feel like they want to say because they've lived, you know, they've worked for 30 years in their life and they've gotten nowhere. And, you know, they see, they misunderstand things like affirmative action. They don't see that the playing field is not level. They think that the playing field for them, and for them, it doesn't feel level because they barely scrape by, or sometimes they don't scrape by, right? And so Trump was kind of, a lot of ways, the embodiment of this, the rage of the poor in a lot of ways, mm-hmm. the rage of the poor whites in particular. And so for me, and I'm not a wealthy individual by any means. We have this false idea that perhaps, you know, professors are well off, but you should look in, you know, for your view, the viewers out there, look into the adjuncting crisis in universities. Mm-hmm. Something like 70% of us faculty are on things like food stamps, and we live under poverty line. And,
Very true. I
mean, you know, we're not, they make like, you know, close to six figures and stuff. Absolutely not, right? So, you know, I have my share of stories of being poor and having to struggle and trying to figure out how to pay for stuff and, you know, debt and all that stuff too. But I think when I look at someone like Trump or any of these other individuals, here's the interesting thing. There was a study, and I think it was the Washington Post during the primary season. And they looked at Trump and Sanders. And what they saw is that the complaints for both of them, for the most part, were the same. The things that they wanted, for the most part, were the same. They wanted more economic opportunities. They wanted access to society. The difference is that the Trump voters had a tendency to want it more personally for them, whereas the Sanders voters wanted it more generally for society as a whole. So what you see is, and I'm not necessarily saying that they're selfish, but what I'm saying is that perhaps this whole rise of Trumpism has to do with not being able to see beyond yourself, not being able to see
an individualism, an individualistic view. I mean,
that's another thing too. This could not have happened without the hard line that we put on individualism in this country. And in reality, individualism is a myth. You can work your ass off for your entire life and still never get anywhere. And many people have that experience. And we have this idea that if you just make good choices all the time, things will work out okay. That's not true. Some people, there is an entire system that favors certain individuals, that discards other individuals. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying you don't have some degree of individual choice. Certainly, some of our choices do cause us to suffer much more greatly than needed, but there's also, you know, the wider society as a whole. We're not a tree. We're just leaves on a tree. You know, we're a part of a whole entire system. And part of the idea of what's going on with a lot of the rise of all these various nationalist groups is exaggerating the role of the individual. Mm-hmm. It's society collectively that must, if individuals are going to do well, it is society as a whole that must do well. You cannot just have a couple of people do really well and step on everybody else.
Well, we'll be back in another Baker's Rebellion.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly it. And now it's neoliberalism instead of just landlords, right? And to some degree, it's landlords too. But it's so all of this stuff is kind of mixed up in that. And as I told you on the phone, the reason I started the show was because I wanted to, Trump wins, right? And I may have done the show either way. It had been an idea rolling around in my brain, but this was kind of the thing that kicked me in the ass and said, okay, I need to do something. And a lot of what I want to do is I want to help people understand, you know, we have a lot of misconceptions about how society works, how it functions, how culture works. You know, things in a lot of ways appear black and white to us, but most things are not. They're very complicated. That's hard. It's hard to live in a gray world. It's a black and white world, but a gray world, well, that's messy. It's not very comfortable sometimes.
Sure.
So, yeah.
Wow. Okay. So, yeah, you have to come back on the show because there's so much more to unpack. And yes, you got to come back on the show with Dr. Badalora. So, So how can people get in contact with you and find out more about your YouTube videos and what you're up to? I know you're writing a fiction novel. You are an amazing video filmmaker, editor, multimedia cat. The work, because you do your own work with your own show. Yeah, and I just love how you shoot it and cut it. It's amazing. So give us some of the things that you got coming up that you're working on and how people can get in contact with you.
So I also do a lot of creative stuff too. But an easy way to follow me is go to my website, which is www.liridianslaboratory.com. And I can give you a link later for you to post in the info or something like that. That's a good way to kind of keep up with on what I'm doing. If you have specific questions, I also go on Quora occasionally, and I answer a lot of anthropology. You'll see I've answered, I think, a few hundred questions on Quora at this point on anthropology. I spend actually a crazy amount of time answering questions on race, and I think that was another reason I was like, okay, I need to do a series on race pretty early on in the show. But we'll be doing a series on gender. We're going to be doing a series on economics and politics. We're going to be doing a whole series on religion and anthropology, human evolution. We're going to be doing all kinds of stuff in the near future. This summer, my schedule has kind of opened up, so I'm going to be able to spend a little more time doing shows. So there'll be a lot more episodes that get up this summer. I also have a Patreon page to support the show. And so if people contribute to the show, they can also choose, if they contribute enough, they can actually pick an episode, or they can participate in question and answer episodes. Which I'm going to do one here pretty soon. I think a Q&A episode based on people's comments. The easiest way is to follow my website. I blog there whenever I'm doing something new, and I post updates to stuff all the time. Easiest way, and there's an email contact there if anyone wants to get a hold of me in that case too. So,
all right.
Yeah, thank you for having me on the show. I very much appreciate it.
Oh, dude, it was absolutely awesome. That was some good science dropping there. I am, you're going to see the comments, so I know they're going to be coming in. So I'm telling everybody, comment and share. I learned something. I hope you guys learned something. We're going to take that and compare it to the stuff that we either already know or think we already know, and move forward. So do me a favor. I keep wanting to call you Doc, which one day I will be calling you that, and it will be true. Stick around with me in the green room as we sign off. Take care, everybody. Again, thank you for watching. This has been a really awesome show. We're going to have Michael Kilman back with Dr. Battalore to unpack even more of the social constructs that came from these anti-miscegenation laws and Bacon's Rebellion, and unpacking the birth and the creation of white people. We'll see you guys next time on the Philippe Matthews Show. Take care, everybody.